The aim today is to step back from the day-to-day and look at some of the bigger issues around media, business and society. The one I'm going to talk about is what I'm calling the truth war, the battle between real news and fake news, and your role in that battle. Just to warn you, I'm going to be posing questions, but I won't be giving you definite answers, partly because I know much less than every one of you about the details of what you do. The best I can do is offer you some suggestions of things to think about in deciding your own responses. This is your client's organisational context. Media is part of advertising, which is just one of the activities controlled by marketing and covered by the marketing budget. The overall quality of customer experience depends on many things and ultimately on the extent to which the whole organisation is customer focused. Much of my own work is about how to make that happen, including the role of marketing, because it's the overall customer experience that drives short-term business performance and through brand equity helps drive long-term performance too. But today, I'm looking beyond even your client's organisational context to the wider societal context of your work. People sometimes say we're living in a post-truth world. I disagree. I think we're living in a world with a mixture of truth and post-truth. And as marketers, we shouldn't just sit back and whinge like Eeyore. As always, we need to bring out our inner Tiggers and bounce back. So the questions today are, what's the role of digital media and advertising in creating post-truth, and what can you do about it? We've all seen this. It can be a bit sad, especially when you remember how social media was supposed to bring people together. Well, actually, I think social media do bring people together, but they also polarise and they dumb down. At the same time, professional journalism is under pressure, although again, that isn't the way it was supposed to be during the early utopian days of the web. Of course, news brands have modernised and are now digital first, but their business models are under pressure, especially because of Google and Facebook, which have huge revenues and huge market power, but invest next to nothing in quality journalism. The internet was also promised a brave new world of citizen journalism, more democratic than the bad old world of centralised big media. You may remember a cartoon on the internet, "No one knows if you're a dog." And again, it was true. We often do have citizens capturing events in real time before the mainstream media can get there. And we have independent bloggers and vloggers building a big presence operating from their bedrooms with no corporate help. But we also have fake news, trolls, and all that. Now, techies tend to be even more optimistic than marketers, and often much more naive about the darker aspects of human nature. These didn't disappear with the launch of the web in 1991. As the number of professional journalists has decreased, the number of PRs has grown. The two lines crossed about 10 years ago. So a growing proportion of what you see in the media has come from or through someone paid to promote a particular viewpoint. So as citizens, we need to support the still substantial army of professional journalists filtering and, where necessary, challenging the flood of stories disseminated by these PRs. Of course, that can't happen with stories that go straight online, or at least it can only happen after the event. And as we know from behavioural research, people often still half believe falsehoods even when they then know them to be false. Another challenge is that with the growth of programmatic, a substantial proportion of the money spent on ads on publisher sites isn't getting through to the publishers who fund the content. These are the WFA's estimates. I don't know how contested they are, and they include a lot of jargon that didn't exist when I were a lad. But everyone seems to agree that programmatic involves a long and not very transparent value chain. According to the WFA, that value chain takes up to 60% of the client's investment. Interestingly, when The Guardian recently bought some of its own advertising, it found that up to 70% was disappearing. It gets worse. Ad fraud accounts for up to 30% or so of internet advertising. That means that the publisher could be effectively getting only 70% of 40%, that's 28% of the client's investment. In the short term, it's the advertiser who's getting ripped off by the fraudsters, but in the long term, it's all of us. What about trust? When I was chairman of Which, the two industries we most focused on were energy and banking. Among all the consumer product and service industries, these two competed to be the least trusted. So I was sorry to see advertising right down there between energy and banking in terms of public trust. I should say that that isn't my view, and it wasn't Which's view. We occasionally quarreled with the ASA about things like actual versus advertised broadband speeds, but in general, we saw them as a rare example of successful industry self-regulation. But, for whatever reason or reasons, the public's level of trust in your industry was pretty low, and I'm genuinely sorry to say that it's now even lower. Trust has fallen across the board, but especially in media and advertising, which by 2015 was trusted even less than banking. Houston, we have a problem. I don't claim to understand it fully, and I'm sure it's linked to the wider mistrust in experts, metropolitan elites, and all that. But whatever the reasons, we need to tackle it. The final issue I want to raise is short-termism. Digital is the latest and most powerful and flexible version of direct marketing. Like all DM, one of its strengths, as you all know, is the ability to measure results. And unlike traditional DM, digital allows very fast test and learn, exemplified by people like Amazon. Of course, that's great, given the relentless pressure on marketers to show a return on investment. However, the danger is that in order to fend off the CEO and CFO, you overinvest in the things you can measure, which, by definition, are those that produce demonstrable short-term results. This is a rerun of the perennial battle in FMCG to limit price promotions and maintain long-term brand-building media investment. Les Binet and Peter Field did a meta-analysis of the IPA data bank, and the question they posed is this one: how is the digital revolution changing the rules of effectiveness? They talk about two ways in which marketing can work. There's long-term brand building and short-term sales activation, 6 months or so. And what they found is over the last 6 to 8 years, the proportion of ad spend going into short-term activation has increased, almost certainly beyond the optimum for building long-term shareholder value. At this perhaps slightly low point, you may very reasonably be thinking, I'm just a very small cog in a very large machine. What can I do about these complex issues and powerful market forces? Here are some suggestions. Well, for starters, you can do your best to get your agency and clients to support Mark Pritchard. You may not like or agree with everything he said, but let's focus on where you, your clients, and the traditional media can find common cause. And that's fraud, viewability, and independent measurement. As a neutral observer, I find it outrageous that Facebook and Google are still marking their own homework, and in Facebook's case, repeatedly having to fess up to miscounting the numbers. Next, think about the importance of the digital media environment. This is the recent Times front page story about reputable brands inadvertently funding people they'd really rather not be associated with. Next, of course, make sure you get and remain fully up to speed on the Newswork research. Of course, it aims to encourage you to invest in news brands, but it's using high-quality researchers like Binet and Field, and there's no shortage of other research trying to persuade you to use other media. Rather than going through that research, which isn't what today's about, I'll give you my personal take on what it's saying and why. To me, it's saying that you should include news brands as part of your media investment because of three sources of synergy. The first, reach, will be familiar to anyone involved in media planning. Because different media have somewhat different audiences, you maximise reach by spreading your investment across media. The second is about diminishing returns within each media type. If you know what you're doing, within each medium, you'll start with the vehicle that gives you the best return, then add the second best, and so on. By definition, you'll get diminishing returns. Beyond a certain point, the best return on the second best medium will be higher than the next best return on the one you first thought of. Finally, different media complement each other by meeting different consumer and advertiser needs. The digerati sometimes talk as if everything is converging. It isn't. At a technical level, reducing everything to the internet protocol does enable different media to share the same networks and increasingly the same mobile devices. But behaviourally, different media still have different economics and meet different needs. At the highest level, there are only two generic types of marketing communication. There are communications initiated by the marketer, and there are communications initiated by the consumer, possibly in response to the first type. The internet is extremely good at the second type, communications initiated by consumers. That's why you no longer see coupons in direct response press ads, and why print classifieds are going the same way. Search, online classifieds, and websites are just better at meeting the same needs. With communications initiated by the marketer, it's much more complicated. The internet is brilliant at some aspects of display advertising, but less good than other media at some others. Hence the need to use a combination of different media to reach as many people as possible, minimize the impact of diminishing returns in each one, and above all, play to their complementary strengths. Finally, do what you can to push back against short-termism. Don't let the numbers drive you down the short-termist hole. And, perhaps more controversially, do everything in your power to avoid activities that might actually reduce shareholder value, both the clients and the news brands. I personally regard wraparounds as an abomination. As a reader, I hate having to extract a newspaper or one of its sections from a crap-laden wraparound deliberately put there by one of you lot in order to disrupt my reading. Similarly, for me personally, most so-called native advertising is simply an annoyance. I'm probably more hostile than most readers, but remember, as a whoopee, that's a well-off older person, I represent a large and growing demographic, and we control quite a high proportion of income and consumer expenditure, and an even higher proportion of household wealth. Here's another thought. I suspect quite a few of our vital hard-pressed journalists hate writing native advertising copy. I may be wrong about that, but it could be worth exploring. Even I don't think all native advertising is bad. Here's a good example from Scottish Widows, part of a much bigger, very well integrated campaign. But here's another thought. If the copy for a piece of native advertising really is so engaging that readers enjoy reading it, why not just make it a traditional long copy advert? What's the benefit of half disguising it as editorial so the reader has to work out that it isn't. Incidentally, the message that including news brands within the mix, as I'm advocating, increases advertising effectiveness hasn't been lost on the digital brands themselves. Say no more, as they said on Monty Python. To conclude, your creative challenge, if you want to do your bit in the truth war, is to do what's right for society and what's right for your client. And assuming your client isn't as difficult as Michelangelo's when he painted the Sistine Chapel, Julius II was an absolute bugger. I mean that in a metaphorical sense here. You may have more scope than you think. To reiterate the point, I'm not saying that you should trade off some of your client's interests in order to benefit society. Your challenge is to think of ways to use media in combination to maximise the return on your client's investment. Based on NewsWorks research, I think that will often mean including a substantial proportion of the investment in news brands alongside other media, and that in turn will help fund quality journalism in a world where we desperately need it. There are some great examples in the traditional creative strategy space. This is one of my favourites. Just look at her. She isn't about to pitch that ball like a girl. Terrific for the brand and empowering for girls around the world. That was Procter. At a corporate level, the big advertiser who's shown the way is, of course, Unilever. Much of that is down to one man, Paul Polman, the CEO. Polman shut down Unilever's corporate social responsibility unit. He said, we're going to take the environment, long-term economic development, and other social issues seriously in everything we do. And 10 days ago, he saw off Kraft Heinz's aggressive attempted takeover in a single knockout blow. Part of that reflected investors' willingness to keep the faith in Unilever's commitment to long-term brand building, as well as its position on social issues. Of course, Unilever still has to press on and probably accelerate its cost-cutting and other improvements, but this example shows it is possible to be nice and still create shareholder value. One reason is that every company is competing for talent, and most people prefer to work for brands and agencies with a purpose. So, in the words of the late great Howard Gossage, changing the world is the only fit work for a grown man. The word that probably jumps out in that quote is man, but remember, Gossage was a contemporary of Mad Men Series 1 when there weren't many Peggy's. So, finally, what will you tell your children or your grandchildren when they ask you what you did in the truth war? Thank you.
As Vanessa said, we're going to ask for your questions and contributions shortly, but if I can kick off, thank you. That was fascinating, I think, for me to hear the academic perspective on the industry we work in. I was curious about whether you were particularly surprised about the client's reaction and perhaps lack of action around the short-term, long-term thing that you highlighted.
Not surprising at all. I think everyone today is operating under massive time pressure and massive pressure to demonstrate a return on investment, not just in marketing, but everyone. And this is actually the topic of my last book, as it happens. This wasn't a put-up job. We now know that the marketing concept works. Okay, we didn't actually know that initially. We now know the marketing concept works. Companies do succeed by profitably, meeting customer needs better than the competition. We also now know that that is more likely to happen if you have a CMO in the top team and you have an influential marketing department. However, there are some systematic reasons why marketers are less influential than they should be. One of them is marketing is mostly about the future, and you know the future is uncertain. One is that most of the drivers of customer experience are people who don't report to marketing, so there's a power gap. And then, of course, there's a massive skills gap because of all the digital stuff, which no one's on top of. So it didn't surprise me at all, because I think marketers are under huge pressure, and the reasons for those gaps are not going to go away. Okay, so this is in 10, 50 years' time, there will still be a pressure to demonstrate short-term results, and we'll always have to work hard to stand up against that pressure.
And are you surprised that clients aren't more around the...
Is this working now? Yeah. Sorry, I was wearing that. I realised this morning I was wearing this microphone a bit like a nipple clamp, so I'm not entirely surprised it's gone wrong, just to lower the tone there. Back to ad fraud.
Yes,
thinking about the client issue then around ad fraud, in particular the value chain that you showed, are you surprised they're not more, given the pressure from them, from CEOs and their financial directors, that they're not more on that side of things?
I think that this is all very recent, actually. That the I don't know when those figures first emerged, but everyone's rather afraid of GAFA, and in our world, particularly Google and Facebook. And there's a reluctance to stand up and sort of shout about it. And it's when people like Procter start doing so, I think other people may start becoming a little bit more courageous. But it's the reasons. We started off with this sort of rather romantic, Grateful Dead, West Coast view of the internet, that it was very democratizing. And the truth is that the economics and the consumer behavior associated with a lot of digital platforms does push you towards a monopoly. And when people have a monopoly, they have a huge amount of power. So I think it's very, very recent that people have realized that this stuff about marking their own homework, this problem with programmatic, this huge value chain, which I say value, which loses a lot of revenue. I think this is all very recent. Shift is extremely timely, both because, with Brexit and especially the Donald, the need for truth seems to me to be pretty clear to anyone with half a brain. But secondly, the sort of more questionable aspects of digital marketing, I think it's very recent that it's become apparent.
And do you think that we as consumers should be more responsible about how we use social media? Should we all be avoiding fake news and thinking about how we use our own Facebook feeds?
That's a good question, and it's a tough one. And it's not only social media, because it is certainly easier to use Amazon and cheaper to use Amazon for a lot of purchases. It's certainly easy to use Google. Okay, so in search, for most of us, there is a consideration set of one. In other words, literally, no, you don't make a brand choice, you just Google something. I think in the case of social media, ideally people would sort of push back a bit. But, the money funding this is advertising money. And so I think pushing back on the numbers and the unreliability on the numbers is one thing. But secondly, taking a, if you like, neutral position on old media versus new media. And avoiding, I mean, you have this with politicians sometimes, where they say, the opposition is proposing an analog policy in a digital world. I mean, what the hell does that mean? Okay, so I think that sort of this sort of animal farm level of analysis, the quote which you had from the nameless, but we now know it was someone writing about car marketing recently in Campaign, Vanessa. I mean, this is just nonsense. Okay, so I think skepticism, and I'm not suggesting people should be biased in favor of news brands because they fund proper journalism, or only a little bit. I'm saying the aim should be to do what's right for your clients by not going for new shiny things and just being grown up and being evidence-based and balanced.
And do you think the falling scores that you showed for trust for different categories are down for media in particular because of the new entrance into that market? So do you think we're all being tarred with the same brush Or do you think it is the category as a whole?
Well, I'm an academic. I'd like some evidence. I don't know the answer to the question. I think that's quite possible. But as political debate has become more polarized, I think that, you know, insofar as you remember the houses with the EU flag and, you know, the Union Jack, and I think that, you know, the US is even more polarized, there's a tendency to have more negative emotion about the views of the people you disagree with than was true 10 years ago. That's, I don't have direct data on that, but there's quite a lot of data which supports that view. So I think it's some combination of new media, you know, communicating a lot of dubious material, which they don't actually create themselves, they're just a channel for nonsense, which may tar the old media, but it's also that I think polarization is just very, very destructive in general and causes people only to listen, increasingly to listen to those they agree with. And that may mean they think, you know, my newspaper is telling the truth, but all the rest are not. But I don't know the answer.
And I wanted to talk to you a bit about your comments around native in particular.
Yes.
So, and displaying my hands here, I work in native, and as a marketeer, I've used native, and would say it's an important part of the mix.
Yes.
Do you think the problem is, and so yeah, you know, without getting into an arm wrestle with you right now, do you think part of the problem might be the same with advertising? It's crap native that people don't like, as opposed to
that's certainly true.
Examples.
I think that logically there can only be three types of native. Okay, there is native, which destroys shareholder value, okay, for the news brand and or the client brand, okay. And in my view, there's quite a lot of that. You know, I'd love to see some research on, which at least explored that. Then there are logically two other alternatives. One of them is it's value creating, but actually, if you took the same copy and didn't do this thing of half confusing the reader and just had it as a traditional David Ogilvy type long copy advert. Okay, we've always known that people will read long advertisements if the content is sufficiently engaging and full of, you know, fancy that type facts or whatever. So logically, there may be some native advertising in which the copy is great, but it would have been just simpler and the reader would have preferred it if you just made it an advertisement and not done this thing of making it sort of look like editorial. And then there probably is some which is in the third category, which is it creates shareholder value and it may create more shareholder value than if you just done this as a long copy advert. I don't know what those proportions are, and as I said, as a whoopee, and I think I'm fairly typical, I may be worse than most, I'm not sure, but you know, I hate all of that. I love advertising, but I hate wraparounds, really annoying. And there's an awful lot of native which I just throw away in a rage.
Okay, so that might be
and
a good
I'm not
time.
A Daily Mail reader, so I don't enjoy being in a rage, I should say.
Before we offend absolutely everyone here, might be a good time to throw it out for some questions, please.
There is an exit here, by the way, before you think, you know.
I'm looking for my team, who are all definitely primed to have a question at this point.
Hi, Nick Hewitt from The Guardian. Excuse me. Is it nonsensical to assume that I think there's a degree of thinking that one day every pound which we use in marketing can be measured. Is it nonsensical to believe that we could track every purchase?
You're absolutely right. And I think that one of the things I argue when I'm sort of in the CMO type space, it's really important not to assume that finance people are stupid. It's really important to say there are understandable reasons for their skepticism about a lot of what they hear from marketers. Therefore, we will sit down with them. We will talk through the reasons we are recommending what we are recommending, which will probably be a mixture of some activities for short-term activation, which are maybe a bit more rational, and some activities for long-term brand building, which may be a bit more emotional. We will provide an evidence-based argument, but CFOs and CEOs absolutely understand the value of brand, and they absolutely understand that there are some things which you can't prove, and that if you only do the things you can prove, you will destroy shareholder value. By the way, we now know, and this is, I have slightly biased on this, because two of the three authors of this study are colleagues of mine at London Business School, but we now know for certain that top executives understand that brands are valuable, and we know that because if they work for a company which has valuable brands, on average, they are paid slightly less. And that's not because they're incentivized to reduce brand equity. It's because, as a CEO, you identify with the brand and you are identified with the brand. And if you're, let's say, a 38-year-old fast-track CFO, then actually the effect is rather bigger than if you were a 58-year-old CFO, because your CV is more important because you have more of your career ahead. So please don't sort of suggest, which marketers sometimes do, they just don't understand brand. They understand brand, but they're very skeptical about a lot of what they hear from marketers. And our collective job is to provide better evidence and analysis to support those conversations. And the absolutely crucial axis is the marketing finance axis. Okay, but you should go into that in a collaborative spirit, not a sort of aggressive defensive spirit. So you're absolutely right, and that will never go away. We will never be able fully to prove the value of brand building investment.
Thank you. Any other questions from the floor? There's one over here.
Yes.
Yeah. Sorry, we're like the Chuckle Brothers. I'm sitting next to them. It's a meet to you. I'm Simon Redican from PAMCO. My question would be, my perception is that for the last few years, the proven media, as they're currently being called, the news brands, magazine media, TV and radio, have probably done the best job in terms of rational argument, in terms of their effectiveness. But we all know that the drift towards Google and Facebook in terms of revenue continues. So that suggests to me that there's an emotional connection with marketers that's not being made, and I wonder what your view is on that, and if you think there's an emotional argument that the proven media could harness.
Well, there's always an emotional argument. You know, that the corporate decision making is always partly emotional, and there is a desire not to be seen as left behind. Okay, I don't know if you remember, you know, before the first internet bubble burst in spring 2000. There was an expression, get it, and the value system was the more digital, the better, in a completely sort of uncritical way. I think actually 2017 is the year in which we're going to be able to challenge that successfully. Now, I'm not saying that this sort of massive trend which we've seen over many, many years into digital is going to stop. I think it's possible it's going to sort of slow down a little bit because there will be more skepticism. But at the very least, we should be able to demand, you know, issues like fraud are addressed much more vigorously than they have been. And in my view, what we need is, and this may be more on the ISPAR side and the equivalent in the States, you know, pressure to say no more marking your own homework. And if you do carry on marking your own homework, we are going to reduce the amount of spend which you're going to get until you can give us better evidence. And I have to say, you will get strong support from CEOs and CFOs for that argument. So you're absolutely right. There is an emotional dimension, and there's also a sort of shiny thing dimension and not wanting to be left behind. As I say, politicians using the word digital meaning good and analog meaning so last century and so bad, not like me. And it's sort of like the vicar using jive talk. It can be quite embarrassing. So I think one of our collective tasks is to just say, stop. Okay, we want a level playing field. And, you know, this desire to be showing how up to date you are and all of that, and all of this nonsense about, you know, the digital generation and no longer watching TV or reading it, anything, and having the attention span of a gnat and all of that. You know, let's bring facts to the party. And by the way, there's a lot of emotion on the right side as well. Okay, I mean, I think most reasonable people are concerned about the fake news and alternative facts and all that. So I think the time is, this year, the time is right for saying we're going to push back.
That's great. We're out of time. Sorry, I think you're staying for coffee later. So if anyone wants to catch Patrick.
I'm staying, yes, yeah.
Thank you very much. That's really interesting.
Thank you.